Hi, we are gradually coming to the end of the course. So welcome to Unit 3 of Week 4, Selecting Learning Resources. I am Professor Inegbedion Juliet Owajaji. First, we need to know what learning resources are. Learning resources are resources that support learning. The resources could be written, spoken, visual, an activity, or a demonstration. These can be classified into two groups as digital and non-digital resources. Examples of digital resources are videos, audios, animations, and images in digital form. The non-digital could be textbooks, novels, magazines, radio and television programs, films, drama, experiments, PowerPoint slides, lecture, panel interview, illustration of different kinds. These resources can be created by the instructor. It can also be selected from existing resources. This is where open educational resources become handy. What we learned in week 3 about open licensing, finding OERs, and using OERs are very important in this instance. You must put into practice the OER knowledge when selecting from existing resources. In Unit 5, we will learn more on how to select appropriate OER to match learning. You also require the knowledge on how to define learning outcomes and activities. You can refresh the lecture in Week 4, Unit 1 and 2. This now takes us to matching the learning resources with learning outcomes and learning activities. The process is carried out during the design stage of the course. Hence, in my previous video, I said online learning is purposeful. It is carefully planned for it to achieve the set objectives. What are the criteria for selecting learning resources? 1. The stated learning outcome or outcomes. 2. The learning activities. 3. Identification of all available resources that match the learning outcomes and learning activities. 4. Selection from various learning resources with due consideration to accessibility. Can learners easily access the material? Are the materials free resources? Are there specific conditions to meet before having access? These are questions that need to be answered when dealing with the issue of accessibility. Again, we look at the cost. The question here will be, is the resource cost free? Who is paying for it? The learners or institution? Then we look at affordability. Is the cost affordable both to the learners and the institution? Institutional policy. What is the institutional policy on the use of commercial resources, self-made resources, and open educational resources? Again, we'll have to look at the quality of resource on how well it will improve learning. Quality here is based on the learning outcome. This is very important when choosing digital resources. Do not be carried away with the aesthetics, but be concerned with the message the resource is sending. Finally, we have to look at the context surrounding the usage. How well does the resource suit the situation in which you want to apply the resource? The fifth one we're going to look at is when creating learning resources. What are those things you will consider? When creating learning resources, consider A, the skill or skills required in the learning outcome or outcome. You can create a resource for one learning outcome, and you can also create for more than one learning outcome. In doing that, you ensure that the resource integrates the required skills in the stated learning outcomes. The level of learning required in the learning activities. Think of how best the skill or the skills can be achieved in the learning activities. The structure. Apart from simple to complex, which may be linear, there are other ways you can sequence your content. You can use scaffolding. You can use hierarchical form, depending on what you want to produce. For example, if you are using the scaffolding method, you want to help to bring up the learner, and at a point, you will be withdrawing the support you are giving to that learner. For example, it's like you want to help somebody, you want to teach somebody how to ride a bicycle. And in the process, at the beginning, you are going to be supporting that person to climb. Even when the person has climbed, is riding the bicycle, you're going to support so that the person will follow. But gradually, at a point, you are going to withdraw that support. When you do that, you are using the scaffolding method. But when you are just starting, start from the simple to complex, starting from the known to unknown. With that, you will be able to sequence your content very well. And that is what we refer to here as structure. You can also use the non-linear. And in this case, you are not moving from simple to complex. You can start from whatever angle. Like in some persons, it was okay, I don't need to define the learning objective. I don't need to do, let me just bring in the content, depending on what best fits in the situation where you are sequencing your data, your content. It also depends on what you observe in the skill or in the learning activities. Because when you want to sequence, remember, you have the learning outcome you have stated. What is the learning outcome you want to achieve? And at the same time, what skill is it that you want that the student will be able to perform, the learner will be able to perform after acquiring the skill? These are all things you will consider when you are sequencing or structuring your content for online learning. Now, be creative in your thinking. You have to apply creative thinking. It is very, very important. Now, in conclusion, today, there are so many resources around us and everywhere. Carefully select resource materials that will improve learning. You may not need to reinvent the wheel where open educational resources are. You can do the work. If OERO can do the work, why reinventing the wheel? Also, do not need to stick to free resources or commercial resources if they do not meet the learning outcome and activities. With this, I say thank you for being part of my class.